good morning. My name is Tanya Neal, and on behalf of our own Dr. Terrence Autry, I'd like to welcome you to Christ Community's online worship experience. Christ Community, you know how we do it. Welcome somebody, high five them, give them a virtual hug just to say good morning. In the meantime, I want to tell you some ways that you can stay connected with us. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, subscribe to our YouTube channel. Those are only a few ways that you can stay connected. Make sure that you check out our gig where you can find out everything that's going on at Christ Community. It's time for us to worship God through giving. The ways that you can give are on our screen right now. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for all that you do to us. There is no way that we can possibly outgive you, Father. I ask that you would bless the gift and the giver. Allow these gifts to be used for ministry and to glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. It's time for me to move out of your way and allow our praise team to take us higher in the Lord. Enjoy your worship experience today.
Lord, we come to you in worship, not just for what you've done for us, Lord, because you've done so much and you deserve worship for that. But Lord, we worship you for who you are, because you're holy, you're good, you're loving, you're graceful. Lord, we just come to worship you today.
Worship.
body. We're going to give it to you. Giving it to you right now, God. You've been so gracious, God. With everything we're going through, God, you have shown yourself to be real. Regardless of COVID-19, God, you are still sovereign. You are still God. We're trusting you. We're trusting you. We're loving you, God. We owe you our worship. You've been so good. You've been so good, God. We love you, Jesus. Is my worship, all of my worship, receive my worship, all of my worship. Sing, y'all.
Is my worship,
all of my
worship.
Receive my
worship,
all of my
worship.
Here it is.
Is my worship,
all of my
worship.
Receive my worship.
All of my worship.
Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Hallelujah.
Thank you,
Lord. We owe you, God. Here's our worship. Receive it, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
Lord, we surely pause to worship you in this Advent season. We just thank you for all that you do. And you are so great. You are so awesome. We honor you. So meet us today as we celebrate this season in which you have come into our lives and make our lives even stronger and better for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning to you all. I hope you are blessed. As we continue into this Advent season, I know 2020 is going to be a little bit different, but at least it'll be memorable and we can talk about what God has brought us through. I hope you've been blessed already by all that's been taking place in the month of December, and I'm really excited about it. Just one reminder, don't forget our drive-by that's coming up. I just want to put some nice things in your hand as we prepare for the closeout for the year, as well as the Christmas celebration. Just some gifts for all of our members, family, friends. Come on by on the 19th, and that's going to be a great, great time and a great experience for all of us. So I want to just continue in our series that we are in, Tis the Season, and I want to look to this theme here for just a few minutes, if I can have your time. I want to invite your attention to Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, and verses 11 and 12. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, verses 11 and 12. I want to encourage you to read all of Matthew 2 in your private time. It's a great story. I think Matthew is raising a significant issue for the early church, and I believe it can be a blessing to you. But for our purposes, we're going to look at the story of the Magi when they came and encountered Herod, and then eventually or ultimately they would encounter Jesus. And so Matthew chapter 2, verse 1 and 2, 11 and 12 reads like this. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, Magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." And then verse 11 through 12 says this, "And after coming into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell to the ground and worshiped him. And then opening their treasures, they presented to him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned by God in a dream not to return to Herod, the Magi left for their own country by another way." And so today I want to talk about 'tis the season for worship, colon, come closer. Would you type that in the chat? Come closer to God. Type that in the chat. Tell somebody, come closer. Come closer. The Advent season really raises one fundamental question for all of us, for Christians, for non-Christians, for people of faith, even people of non-faith, all of creation. And the question it raises, how do we draw closer to Him? How do we come closer to God? And particularly all that we've been through in 2020 and what this year has been like, is there anybody in the chat that would love to get a little bit closer to God? It doesn't suggest that by trying to be closer to God that somehow we're reprobate or somehow that we're infidels. We're not trying to draw closer to God as if somehow we're more spiritually astute and mature than the next person. And surely we're not trying to say that we're God's select or chosen, because sometimes the chosen are more frozen. No, we're simply suggesting we need to draw closer to God. We all need to draw closer to Him, because the world is not as bad when I'm closer to Him, because the stress and the anxiety fades when I'm closer to Him, because life, even in this world with the pandemic and the economy and the politics and all the chaos and the division, does not seem to bother me as much when I'm closer to Him, because my losses do not signal the end of my life when I'm closer to Him. And because, most importantly, when my heart is broken, it's made whole when I'm closer to Him. The Advent season raises the question, how do we draw closer to Him? The dominant theme and the message that we try to live up to is that it's a call. It's God's call to all of us to come closer. That's what the Advent season is. It's the call of God. Come closer. Come closer. Don't be afraid. Come closer. Don't think that you have to remain at a distance. Come closer. Don't think that somehow you have to be perfect. Come closer. But Pastor, I'm an outsider. Come closer. But Pastor, I'm a person of non-faith. Come closer. But Pastor, I have not been the practicing Christian. I've been very marginal this year with my worship. Come closer. Pastor, if you only knew what I did last night. Matter of fact, Pastor, if you only knew what I did this morning. Yes, you, come closer. The Advent season is a call to all of us to come closer. It's extremely difficult for us as Americans, particularly in our democracy, to capture this idea of worship under the theme of Jesus as a king. It really is a challenge. We have our freedoms, we have our democracy, and our individual rights, and it's hard to really enter into this worship theme when we talk about Jesus as king. Maybe if we were British or if we were Chinese or in China, we could capture a glimpse of it as they understand what it means to have a monarch or an emperor. But understand, in that culture, it was much like that kind of time where there was a where monarchs and emperors rule. That is, that if you were to enter into the presence of a king or a monarch, it was literally life and death. say the wrong words, it could mean death. Approach the king in a way that goes against royal protocols, it could mean death. Fail to pay the king the homage that he is rightfully due, it could mean death. It was a dreadful and a fearful experience to come into the king, to come into the presence of the king, you didn't know what you were to expect. But this Advent season gives us a different king. It is a newborn king. Matter of fact, it reminds me of the first time I held my sons when they were newborns. Do you remember that time? Do you remember the time that you held a newborn in your arms? I don't know about you. That's a time that no one can ever forget. For me, it seemed like time was frozen. It seemed like the world was perfect. There was a pure joy, a pure exhilaration that came upon me. Of course, there was the trepidation and the fear and responsibility that came with raising that newborn that I held in my arms. But for just a moment, I felt free. I felt joy. I felt fullness. Whatever life was meant to be, I found it in holding that newborn. The Advent season is about a newborn king. No royal protocols to worry about. No fear and trepidation as if to lose your life when you come into his presence. No hoops to jump through. Just a newborn that is waiting for us to hold him to experience the freeness and the goodness and the peace that comes with his wonderful presence. Can you hear the Advent call this morning? Come closer. Would you type it in the chat and tell somebody, you can come closer. You can come closer. There's an inspiring documentary on Netflix entitled Voices of Fire. It's an amazing story about worship. It's about a choir. It's a story of a pastor that had a vision. The pastor is actually the uncle of Pharrell Williams, that singing phenom. And this pastor, he has this vision where he wants to assemble the best choir in that region. And he wants to tour the globe singing the gospel in song. He believes that many times what words may fail to do, the gospel with music can do. It can communicate that incredible message of unconditional love. And so they had the auditions, they had the rehearsals. And many would come to audition to be a part of this choir. Some 3,000 participants wanted to be in this choir. And many that came were not Christians. And many that came were. And the pastor stated he wasn't worried about that. He wasn't worried about all the differences and all the different backgrounds that people brought to the worship. He knew that something would happen once a blending would take place. He knew that once they came together and began to blend and to harmonize, that the Spirit of God would take over and they would grasp the Spirit, the power and the presence and the intensity of God's Spirit in that place. And then he said with these words, and the tears will fall and hearts will be softened. And you know what? As I watched it, that's exactly what happened. The tears did fall and hearts were softened. Individuals that came from diverse personalities and diverse backgrounds and this eclectic approach to singing came together and somehow by the power of God's Spirit were transformed into an inspiring and encouraging choir or community with a message of love and peace and the gospel for all to hear. And as they rehearsed and as they went through their auditions, the tears did fall and hearts did soften. And I have to be honest with you, church, even tears fell down my face and my heart was softened as we all drew closer to him. Can you hear the call this Advent season? Come closer. Come closer. That's what the Advent season is about. It's about coming closer. That's the heart of worship. Worship is simply drawing closer to God. Each worship experience ought to bring us one step closer to him. But the truth is, church, we live in a day in which worship can get predictable, in which worship can get methodical, in which worship can be mechanical. And let's be honest, now that we're in this sheltered-in-place COVID reality, worship can be full of distractions. Shoot, I know y'all played with your cell phones when I preached in person. I can only imagine what you're doing right now. If you can't say amen, you can at least say ouch. And that's not a shot at anyone. I'm just as guilty, church. I'll be honest with you. The truth is, there's so many things competing with our attention. There's so many things that are coming at us in this unusual space that we find ourselves in, that the question needs to be raised, do we really draw close to him? I know something happens supernaturally when we all come together as a community to worship, but right now we don't have that privilege. But can we draw close to him in this unique space? That's what our text is aiming at. The Magi, that's exactly what they did. They came closer. They drew closer to the Savior. In our text, everybody hated Herod just as much as we sometimes hate our own politicians. And yet, in a very subtle and subversive way, Matthew is communicating a message to the early church, and he's communicating a message to us. I know there's somebody that's in power that you don't like, but the question is, will you draw closer to him? I know it's easy to think that someone in office actually holds the power, but the truth is, the one in the manger is the one that really holds all the power. And just because we hate the one in office does not mean we love the one in the manger. We're called to draw closer to him. And so, in verse 2, it says that they came from the east, and they had journeyed and arrived in Jerusalem, and it speaks to how far these Magi had traveled, that they had traveled thousands of miles to come to see and to worship the Savior. And if I can just make a few observations very quickly. Number one, I would say worship is a journey. It is an expedition. It is a pilgrimage without being Muslim. It is a journey that we do every single moment when we engage him, and not something we do once in a lifetime. It is a journey. Old church that I grew up in, they had what was called a vestibule. The vestibule was the waiting area that congregants and worshipers would wait before they would enter into the sanctuary, because there were sacred moments going on in the service. Maybe the preacher was preaching, or maybe the choir was in the midst of a song. So you waited in what was called the vestibule. And what you were supposed to do, you were to prepare your heart to receive what God had for you, whether with prayer, with confession, or meditation. We live in a day now that we don't have vestibules. We have lobbies and lounges and coffee spaces. And surely there's nothing wrong with that. All that is good and all that has its proper place. There's a real spiritual experience when the people of God congregate together. But I have to ask myself the question, have we lost the journey? Have we lost the preparation that goes into worship? I had a chance to stand on the steps in Jerusalem that would lead up into the temple. And though it is some 2,000 years old, you can still see those steps. You can stand on them. And the steps are not all the same in terms of length and width, but each stair step is a little bit different. One step may be 6 inches. The next step may be a foot. The next step may be a foot and a half. The next step may be 2 feet. And then the next step may be 4 inches. And all the way up from the bottom to the front doors of the temple, each step is a different length. Why? Because when we come, the designers wanted the worshipers to understand that when you come into the presence of the king, when you come before him, you can't come the same way. You come and you think about how it is a different approach to him, that as we come before him, we're to prepare ourselves and to prepare our hearts as we enter into the presence of God. I also had the privilege to travel up the mountain that led up to Jerusalem into the holy city. And as I was riding with about 30 individuals on the bus that day, I never shall forget, because it was a peculiarly transformative experience in which there was a lot of talking and bantering and back and forth. But as we were traveling, the tour guide began to share the story how the worshipers and the pilgrims, those on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem, would travel up that mountain. And while they were traveling up that mountain, they would recite the Psalms as they were prepared to go into worship. And as he was telling the story, he began to recite the Psalms for us. And all the talking and the bantering and all the sidebar conversations all of a sudden came to a silence. And in that transformative moment, it's almost as if we can sense the hush of God in that place as we begin to enter into his presence right there in the bus. It's almost as if the engine itself went silent and that all would worship. Because worship is a journey. It's a trek. It's a pilgrimage into the presence of God in which we prepare ourselves to engage Yahweh, our King. And so also here in this text, that's what the Magi understand. They travel thousands of miles to prepare themselves. And maybe the reason why we remain at a distance, because we've lost the journey. We've lost the quest. We've lost the trek into his presence. Some of us are saying, well, Pastor, you know, it shouldn't take all that. Just get to the meat. I used to be like that. We don't need the worship. Just get to the word. Just tell me what you're going to say so I can move on. No, it does take all that because he's worthy. He's worthy of all that. I've done some weddings, and I've done some weddings. I never shall forget one particular wedding, and the groom was telling me how far he went to propose to his bride. He says, you know what? I took her all the way to Europe. Because I wanted to make sure I had the right place. I wanted to make sure I had the right atmosphere. I wanted to be in the place of love. I wanted her to know how much I loved her. I said, why did you do something like that? That's a lot of money that you spend. He said, I wanted her to know that the travel was worth it. My brothers and sisters, that's what worship is about. Is it worth it? Is the journey worth it? Is it worth it to go through all that we go through to get to the place where we can worship him, where we can draw close to him? Is it worth it? Is it worth it? Sometimes we're going to come across some obstacles. We're going to come across some detours. And even in this text and in the story, Herod surely was a detour. He was an obstacle. But thank God that the Magi says, look, we're not going to let him stop us. We're going to worship the King. Because the King has called us to come closer. We're going to worship him. That's why whenever we do in-person worship, sometimes when people begin to worship, you don't know what they've been through. And I don't give people a hard time about their worship when they let loose in worship. Matter of fact, I think we ought to have some emojis that we can put in the chat that kind of lets everybody know that we're letting loose. Not that we're trying to show off or be performative, but many times you don't know the journey that we had to go through to get to this place with God. You don't know the valleys we had to walk through. You don't know the hills we had to climb. You don't know the rivers we had to swim and all the Herods and the Mrs. Herods that we had to move out of our way just to get to the place to give him the worship that he's worthy. And so, yes, my worship may be a little different. Yes, my worship may be a little bit boisterous, but there's a witness and there's a journey in my worship as to why I come to where I come. It's a journey, but also it's a calling, because verse 2 says, we saw his star from the east and we've come to worship him. We saw his star. Thousands of miles away, we have traveled and we saw his star and we've come to worship him. The text raises the question, how many saw the star but didn't bother? That's the danger of worship. Here, these Magi, they travel thousands of miles, and it's not like today, y'all, where we can just hop on a plane and fly to where we're trying to get in a couple of hours. No. They may have traveled, 15, 20 miles a day at best. You're talking about months of travel. And they make this travel, they trek. And they don't mind making the trip because they recognize it's a call to all of creation. It's a reference back to what God intended from worship from beginning in Genesis all the way to Revelation, that all of creation is called out to worship. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and they that dwell therein, everybody is called to worship him. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. Not just the children, the adults, but the trees and the animals and the mountains and the valleys. Everything is called to worship him, because there's a call in creation to worship our God for who he is, because he's worthy. And you know, when I run, you know, y'all know that I do my exercise. I try to do it on a regular basis, just about every day. And particularly when I'm running early in the morning, I try to get ahead of this thing and start out early in the morning with my runs. I'm convinced that creation gets its worship going. I'm convinced of that. I kid you not, because many times when I'm out running, I can hear the birds singing. And you would think there would be, you know, a cacophony of singing and voices, that there's this discordant kind of sound that is taking place. But there's a sense that the birds, when they're tuning up, they're trying to sing one harmony as if they're singing to one person, or they're singing to God himself. There's a sense that when I'm running sometimes, that the wind begins to howl. It's cold outside, but you can hear the wind howling as if it's trying to say hallelujah. There's a sense that as the wind begins to howl, that the trees start to move from left to right, as if somehow they're beginning to feel the Spirit move in creation. And if you look closely, it's like the limbs begin to wave their hands as if they want to join in the worship. I've even been in places where I've seen rabbits and squirrels while I'm running. They're running around in circles, and there's no fox, there's no dog that is chasing them. And I've said to myself, I've seen that in church. Looks like even creation is responding to the call to worship. And God, through the Advent season this year, calls us, church, to come closer. Tell your neighbor in the chat, come closer, come closer. How many saw the star but didn't bother to worship? I can catch it at another time. It's always available online. I can do it when it's convenient for me. Oh, church, he's worthy. He's worthy of the worship. It is a journey. It's a calling. But more importantly, here's where I'm trying to land this plane. It is ruin. Worship is ruin. R-U-I-N. It's ruin. Please don't miss this in the text. Look what it says in verse 11. And after coming into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell to the ground and they worshiped him. Interesting to me, the word that Matthew chooses to describe worship, letting us know he knows something about worship. He doesn't say they sang and worship. He doesn't say they shouted and worship. He doesn't say they adored him and worship. It doesn't even say they paused for a silent meditation. They fell and worship. Oh, that's powerful. Almost some 37 times in Scripture, Jesus is recorded as to performing some form of miracle. And one consistent theme after each miracle is this: they gave praise and glory to God. And thousands of people followed Jesus for the miracles he did. But after his crucifixion and resurrection, when he shows up at the Mount of Olives and he begins to send out the disciples, only 120 people are there. And the question becomes, well, what happened to the thousands? And why only the 120? Because there's a difference between praise and worship. You can have praise, but that doesn't mean you have worship. Praise will get you in the crowd, but worship will get you close to him. And there's a distinct difference between praise and worship. Matter of fact, if you want to know the difference between commitment and non-commitment, it's the difference between those that simply praise and those that come and render worship. And it's all found in this word fell. The word fell, it has the idea of being completely torn to pieces. There's a sense in the text as they saw the little toddler Jesus. He wasn't an infant here in this text. No, he's about 2 years old. He's a little toddler. He's in his terrible twos, tearing up everything. But there's a sense in the text when they came into his presence, they completely lost it emotionally. Jesus uses a variation of this same word when he concludes his Sermon on the Mount. And he talks about those who heed his word and those who don't heed his word. He says, look, those who don't heed my words, they're like the person that builds a house on sand. And when the winds come and the storms and the rains and all the hurricane stuff comes, the house fell. Literally, the house was torn to pieces. Imagine a tsunami hitting a house on the beach. It's completely obliterated. That's the sense of this text here, that when the Magi came into the presence of Jesus Christ, they were completely torn to pieces. They completely lost control. They were ruined. Like Isaiah, I am undone. I'm a man of unclean lips. And that is worship. Worship is losing control. And that is the problem, is it? Because a lot of times when we come to worship God, particularly in person church, you know, we're trying to hold it together. Sometimes the Spirit is really moving. Sometimes the Spirit is convicting. Sometimes the Spirit is encouraging us. It could be in the singing. It can be in the praise. It can be in the prayer. It can be in the preaching. But somehow the Spirit of God is moving. But because people are watching, we're trying to hold it together. The problem is, as long as we're in control, God can't be in control. But the moment I lose control, God can take that thing over. Anybody know God can get in control when we worship Him? So I remember as a kid, this just brought back some memories. In my church growing up, you knew when you had worship in your church. All you had to do was look at people after the service. Because many times before the service, people came to church, they were all dressed up, they had their suit and ties on, they had their hats, they had their wigs, they had all their nice makeup, they had all that stuff going on. But if the worship was really something, people left that place, tie was completely out of place, shirts were sweating, hats were all disheveled, and wigs were all twisted around, makeup had streamed down. Because worship had happened in this place, people were completely torn to pieces, and they didn't care how they looked. All they know is they had encountered the presence of the Almighty, and He had ripped us to pieces. Because worship is about being free. Free to express our hearts to Him. Worship is about having the breath to share our hearts. That's why in the Old Testament, there were so many expressions of worship. Whether it was praise, whether it was prostration, whether it was shouting, whether it was the lifting of the hands, whether it was kneeling or bowing, or even if it was silent meditation and solemn silence before the Lord. Each expression was a demonstration of yielding control of one's life to Him. Worship is ruined. Have you been ruined when you come into His presence? I know somebody's saying right now, Pastor, I'm already torn to pieces. That's why this holiday season is so difficult. This year has been so difficult. I don't need to get ruined when I come into the presence of God. I'm already ruined. Just what I've gone through, the losses I've suffered. The truth is, when I come to worship, Pastor, I don't feel like worship. I don't have the spirit. I don't have the celebration. But guess what? My word to you is that bring your tears as well. Matter of fact, there's a word in that God probably responds to the tears more than He responds to the praise. That's the kind of God He is. Matter of fact, drop down to verse 18, and you'll discover that Herod, when he's tricked and he realizes that the Magi don't tell him where Jesus is, he orders the slaughter of every child under the age of 2 years old. And thankfully, Joseph and Mary are able to escape with Jesus. But there were many children that suffered. And Matthew, when he describes this horrific event of grief and mourning, he quotes Jeremiah chapter 31 with these words in Matthew 2 and verse 18. A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping in great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and she refused to be comforted because they were no more. And here Matthew tries to capture the grief and the mourning of God's people because of the dastardly deed that Herod did, slaughtering innocent children for no reason. And in that, God is saying, bring your grief. Bring your tears. Yes, that's appropriate. Tears that God hears. And many times He responds to the tears more than the praise. Jesus said, blessed are they that are comforted. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. And that's exactly what happened in the text, that once the tears had fallen, God did a work on Herod and took him out, and Mary and Joseph and Jesus were able to return to Nazareth. And usually it's after our tears before God that God moves and does something. And so worship is ruined. So a couple of things I just want to suggest to you, that we can come closer to God as we heed Him in this Advent season. Number one, make sure you bring the focus. When we come to worship God, bring the focus. Make sure we focus on Him. Make sure we focus on Him. When we focus on Him, He draws closer to us. When we make Him the center of attention, every time I read verse 11, I'm blown away that when they came in, the first thing they saw was Jesus. They saw the toddler. Didn't see the mother, didn't see the father. I don't know what was in that house. Maybe it was wonderful furniture. Maybe it was decoration. I don't know. Maybe it was a celebration at some Jewish festival, but they didn't see all that. They saw Jesus. And when they saw him, they fell before him. They were torn to pieces. They saw the substance instead of the form because they had focus. And we've got to bring focus to our worship. We've got to put away all the distractions. We've got to put away all the stuff that would cause us to miss and focus in on what God is doing. I'll be the first one to admit that when I'm watching a worship service online, I got many distractions that are coming at me. There are texts on my phone, there are emails coming at me, there are opportunities to click on another link and do something else. And y'all, we've got to create the environment that when we come to worship online, we've got to eliminate and remove all the distractions. So one of the things that I've started doing just this past week, and it blessed me immensely, I put my phone down and I logged in through my smart TV, and I watched the worship service on my smart TV by myself right there in the living room where I can focus just on the worship. I'm not tempted to reach to my computer. I'm not tempted to answer a text, but I can focus in and worship God for who he is, and to render him the worship, and to hear from him clearly. Focus. Focus. We got to bring focus to our worship. I would also add in that, in bringing focus underneath that, we also need to bring preparation. Got to prepare our hearts. Maybe we take a few minutes before we start the service just to kind of get our minds right, to get our spirit right, because you know we got a lot of things going on our mind. The Bible says the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. That when the Lord is in his holy temple, we ought to be silent before him. And so sometimes maybe we just got to pause for a few minutes before we come into his presence and prepare our minds with silence. And all of our thoughts that are running in our head, to calm all that stuff down so that we can experience his presence. Maybe it's a time of confession, to confess the things we need, to confess the things we should have done, to confess our sins, to confess our needs of him. Maybe it's a time of thankfulness. Just thankful, God, that you've brought me to this point of worship, and I want to render to you this worship because I love you this much. Make sure we bring the focus. The second thing, we got to bring our best. We want to bring our best because in this text, in verse 11, it says they opened up treasures for him. Notice that this is not an offering. Treasures represent their best. They dug deep, y'all. They went into their savings. They went into their 401ks. They went into the stuff that they treasured the most because they said he was worthy. We ought to always bring our best to him. I want to give you a scripture here. Put here Matthew chapter 5, verse 48, where Jesus says, "Be ye perfect as I am perfect." That's a great scripture for worship. I know many of us, when we hear that scripture, we think that God is calling us to perfection. And I don't think that's what he's doing. It's not the best translation there. And we know that we are all flawed and we can't bring any kind of human perfection to the worship and the adoration of God. And so I don't think it's talking about perfection. Some have suggested that he's talking about maturity. And maybe it is a sense of maturity on my part, but then it says, "Be ye perfect," or "be ye mature as God is mature." Wait a minute, you mean to tell me God matures? God has never grown. God has never aged. God doesn't need to mature. But no, I think the sense of the text, there's another nuance in the word, that Greek word. And the word has the idea as bring your best, because God your Father always brings his best. It does have the nuance that would suggest perfection in God. But in that perfection, there's a sense that with the perfection he brings, it's his best. So in a sense, God knows I can't bring perfection because I'm flawed. I was born in sin, but it does not keep me from giving God my best, from rendering to him my best. And so when we worship him, yes, listen, church, even when we don't feel like it, we recognize he's worthy. He deserves all the praise. He deserves all the glory. Therefore, because it is worship, we give him our best. My friend McKinley Haley, he's gone on to be with the Lord, influenced me so greatly with this principle.
who had a strong calling on his life about worship, and in his sharing of his life and his struggles and how God brought him through his struggles, he said it was God teaching him that when I give my best in my love and my adoration of him, he delivered me from my struggles. Also, too, I would argue that's what worship is. We come to him regardless of where we are and give him our best. Why? Because he always gives us his best. When he gave Jesus, he gave us his best. When he gives us a blessing, he gave us his best. When he gives us the fullness of the Spirit, he gives us his best. When he comes back again to gather us onto his own, he gives us his best. If he gives us his best, should we not, in worship, give him our best? I was asked the question this week, Pastor, how do you know what your passion is? We live in a culture that is very, very concerned about the purpose. They don't want to die having missed their purpose. And so purpose is connected to passion. And I was asked the question, well, Pastor, how do you know your purpose? And when you get in your purpose, how do you know it's your passion? The worst thing you want to do is to get into something only to discover it's not really your passion. And I think with that question, that many times what we're looking for perfection and not passion. We're looking for the perfect situation that's going to bring us some sense of heaven on earth. And I'm here to tell you, it doesn't exist. The only time we'll find that kind of perfection is when we arrive in heaven and we're in his presence, because Jesus all by himself is what makes perfection perfect. But what you will find is you will find a passion when you're willing, here it is, to give yourself wholly to whatever it is you believe God is calling you to do. In other words, as I told this individual that asked me the question, how do you know the passion? I said, you're not going to know if it's perfection. It's going to have flaws. It's going to have challenges. But you are willing to jump in both feet first. And whatever the consequences are, you're okay with it. That's what passion is. Passion means I jump into it with my all. I give my all. And it may go well, it may not. Hopefully it does. But whatever the consequences are, it doesn't matter, because I've given my life totally to this. I believe I was made for this moment. And that's what it means to be people of worship who understand the Advent season to be our moment in which we honor our King. We recognize because he jumped into the world feet first with his all, we jump in to worship feet first with our all because he is worthy. Bring the focus, bring your best, and lastly, bring the map. Bring your map. Because in this text, watch this, the text says, as they drew closer to him, God moved in such a way that they left going in a new direction. Look what it says in verse 12. Having been warned by God in a dream not to return to Herod, the Magi left for their own country by another way. And that's what God does, that many times we don't realize that what we're looking for, it doesn't happen before the worship, it happens after the worship. That many times we're coming and we're kind of waiting to see what God's going to do before. No, we got to go through the ruin. We got to go through the breaking. We got to go through all that. But boy, if you go through it for God, if you go through the journey, if you go through all the and answer the call, if you go through the ruin, all the stuff that comes with worship, on the other side, God will give you a map and take you into a new direction that will bless and enrich all of our lives. Does it mean that he eliminates all the problems in our lives? No, it doesn't mean that. But what it does mean, your problem has a new problem, and that's you. Because you've been restored. You've been renewed. You've been given a new direction. You've been given a new vision. You've been given new hope. You've been given a new anointing, a new fullness of God's Spirit and his presence. And you have the power and the determination to deal with that problem in a way that that problem has never been dealt with before. Because real worship has taken place. Come closer. Come closer. And so that's my word to you. And I want to close with this. And then we want to close with some sweet worship to him, because he's worthy during this Advent season. One writer described it like this, and I think it's just so on point. He says, worship is the difference between marbles and grapes. Marbles and grapes.
That's the difference with worship. He said, a lot of people, when they worship, they're like marbles. But then a lot of people, when they worship, they're like grapes. And he's trying to make a point about the church. He says, people who worship like marbles, you know, they're always moving. They can't be still. They're bumping in, ricocheting all over the place. 1 minute they're here, 1 minute they're over here, 1 minute they're over there. And they never come to a place that they're settled. And the truth is, it's because on the inside, they're so hard and they're so tough on the inside. They've never been touched in such a way where they can find a sense of stability and peace. But worship for other people are like grapes. Grapes, though tender on the outside, if they're squished, they release something sweet on the inside. And in a sense, this writer was saying that's what God does. He takes all of us, his people, and he takes us through the vicissitudes of life, the struggles, the trials, the persecutions, the hurts, the losses, the pains, the bad reports. And through all that, we're bruised and we're squished. And he brings us all together. But having been squished by the trials of life, it releases a sweet flavor of juices that are mixed together as a beautiful elixir for us and the world of what God can do. He can take us as a cluster of grapes and break us and make us into a sweet elixir that is a blessing to God and a blessing to the world. So that when the church comes together, something sweet is released, something good happens. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Taste his people and know that sweetness resides on the inside. And so as we come to the conclusion of this word, let's make some juice together. Let's yield our hearts in worship to him in this moment.
Oh,
worthy. Didn't we make juice together? That's what worship is. That's what the Advent season is about. Come closer. Type in the chat. Come closer. Tell somebody, come closer. He's a newborn. Come closer. He's the newborn king. Come closer. He's still the same. Come closer. And that will enrich our worship. That will give us the experience of his presence. God bless you. That's the word I believe God has for us. And as we celebrate this Advent season, if you're watching and you've never trusted Christ, that's where God's trying to take you. That's why all of human history will wrap up. Listen, there won't be any preaching. There won't be any messages. There won't be ministry, none of that, because we'll be in that perfect place. And the one thing we will be set aside to do for the rest of our lives is to worship him. We'll join in with the angels to worship him. And we're actually here on earth right now preparing for that time when we'll be in his presence forever with worship. And he's calling you. He's calling you out just as he calls the birds and the bees and all of his creation. He's calling you this Advent season to come closer. Would you come closer today? The gospel is very simple. Christ died for our sins and rose from the dead. He made the way for you to come closer. That's what the Advent season is about. He wants you to come find or rediscover your rightful place in his presence with him. Will you come closer? If you've never accepted Jesus Christ, this is your moment. This is what Christmas is for. This is why he was born into this world, for you, that you can come closer to God without fear, without trepidation, without horror, but with faith and hope, and to believe that God can transform our lives and give us a journey that's worth living. The gospel is very simple. I just stated it for you. We're going to do the gospel invitation at this time. And if you've never trusted Christ, I want to lead you in this moment of prayer. I want to encourage you to trust Christ. And the Bible teaches that if you pray this believing, not only will he save you and make you a part of his kingdom, but he will use you to make a difference in this world. If that's you, can I pray with you right now today? Can I make your Christmas something really special today? I believe that's what God wants to do. Let's pray. Father, we bless you and thank you again for this season, this Advent season, that we celebrate the newborn King and we celebrate worship as we come closer. And we want to come closer today, Lord. We want to come closer with every step that we might experience your presence and your power. And somebody's watching today, Lord, and this Christmas season is their moment. They've never trusted you. And this is their moment. And I pray that as the wise men came from a distance, Lord, they would know they can come close right now. They can come and receive you as Savior. They can come and begin to bow down before you. If that's you, I want to lead you through this prayer. It's on the screen right in front of you. I'll lead you through it. If you pray it, believing it, repeating it after me, God will save you. He will do that. It's very simple. Simply repeat these words. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you that you died and rose for my sins. Thank you for the forgiveness of sins. I accept you as my Savior and my Lord to make a difference in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. God bless you. We celebrate you, because you've taken a major step for God. You've taken the step of the Magi. You've made the journey that's going to be complete in your life. So much God wants to pour in your life. We want to be a part of helping you discover that. On your screen is on the screen in front of you, there's an email address, life@ccrichardson.org. If you email us, let us know your decision. Listen, I trusted Christ for the first time. We're not trying to shame you, embarrass you. We want to help you on your journey. We will follow up with you, share with you your next steps, encourage you on this journey, just like the Magi, that you also may begin a relationship with Christ. God bless you. That's what Christmas is all about. And you took the first real step toward real worship and celebration in him. We celebrate you today. God bless you. But then there's some watching. You're a Christian, but you're not connected to a faith community. And the community, the gathering, is the place. And I know we're in this sheltered in place existence right now, but there's going to come a time we're going to be all together as well. And so maybe you're in Dallas and you need a place where you can connect with us in person. But even if you're not in Dallas, maybe you're watching from another part of the country. And we do have those who are watching from other parts of the country and are being ministered to, and they're being able to connect with us digitally. In either space, you need to be connected. You know Christ has created community where we come together and we can make something sweet for the world when we worship Him. And God wants you to be a part of that. If that's you, would you email us at life@ccrichardson.org and just let us know, look, I want to partner with Christ community. I want to help Christ community with the vision to make a difference in this world. I want to be a part of that community. And we surely will help you be a part of all that we believe God has called us to do and wants to make a difference in this world. God bless you. We're so proud of you. To all of our guests, thank you for sharing and watching with us. Thank you for sharing this broadcast. You are helping grow our broadcast. And I want to encourage you to click on that guest link right there in the description box. Fill it out. Just want to send you a gift. Let you know we appreciate you. And we surely know that God is doing something special in your life, and we surely want to be a part of all that He's doing in your life. We want to help you on that journey, just like the Magi, that you also may experience the powerful, transformative experience in Christ during this Advent season. God bless you. May God keep you. Christ community, that is our call. Come closer. Tell somebody you can come closer. That's what the Advent season is. This is our time. We draw and experience the transforming power of His presence in worship. Let's do that and watch God do an incredible work in our lives. Let's get the benediction. You are the light of the world. And so go now, knowing that worship is indeed a journey in which God walks with us. It's a calling. And when we worship, we make something very sweet together that God uses not only to enrich and bless us, but to bless this world. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, and I'll see you next week.